So welcome to the final panel, which, as you see from your program, is China, Human Rights, and International Engagement. And I can't think of a better group of people to address this. And in the interest of time, I'm going to keep the introductions very, very short indeed. And we are told that we do have a bit of extra time. So if you see Harold Koh, give him a coffee or something, as we keep him slightly waiting at the end of it. So I'm José Alvarez. I teach here. And I'm very privileged to chair this panel on multilateral engagement. So let me just say a few words about what you'll hear from each one. So Sharon Holm, who, as you see, is the Executive Director of Human Rights in China, will be addressing multilateral engagement and mechanisms, specifically in the Human Rights Council, the Universal Periodic Review. Felice Gaer, who is familiar to many of you, I am sure, the American Jewish Committee's Jacob Blaustein Institute for the Advancement of Human Rights, will be addressing UN treaty bodies, including the one that she's most familiar with, the Committee on Torture. And Sophie Richardson, China Director of Human Rights Watch, will address bilateral relationships, such as, for example, US-China, EU-China relations. And finally, our distinguished commentator is my colleague Anne and Joel Eisenkratz, Professor of Law and co-chair of the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice, Ryan Goodman, who's also inaugurated a new blog for many of you called Just Security. Just security and all that may mean in various ways of thinking about that. So we're actually going to make things very easy for you. We're going to start actually in the order that you see in the program. So Sharon Holm, take it away.
Great. Thank you so much. I'm going to focus on, I think of it as the universe in a grain of sand, and this particular grain of sand is the Universal Periodic Review process and the Human Rights Council, where this process takes place. This is an example of one of the multilateral fora that can, and we can look at some of the challenges presented for advancing human rights in this forum. And also, I don't want to overstate it because it's such an uphill, like at 90 degree kind of struggle. I want to also look at some of the mini milestones, if that's not an oxymoron, for progress within these very complex processes. So let me begin by just setting a very fast sort of, you know, as the Chinese expression, you know, we're going to look at looking at flowers riding on a horse galloping by. And I wanted to set the frame by looking at two aspects of China's international obligations, because that's the frame for talking about Universal Periodic Review, UPR. So the first frame is China's Human Rights Council pledges. And as you know, China just got elected to the council. But before it got elected, it made pledges. These are voluntary. So that means these are what China chose to put out. And I'm not going to go through all of them, because you can read it quicker than I can orally go through, you know, read them. But the importance about these pledges is that they echo and implicate domestic human rights, rule of law, good governance, and most importantly, minsheng issues, like lives that impact the daily lives of people. So these are the economic, social, and cultural rights. Secondly, they're also talking about protecting the rights of vulnerable groups, including ethnic minority groups, women, children, etc. And then the third aspect of this is that it is a pledge to actively be an active player at the Human Rights Council and the third committee where the human rights issues are often raised at the General Assembly. These pledges are important because when we go through the UPR process, we can see what they actually mean in implementation by China. The second international obligation framework is China's human rights obligations under the treaties. So China has signed on to all of these treaties with respect to rights of the child, torture, discrimination against women, racial discrimination, economic, social, cultural rights, rights of persons with disabilities, and has ratified and yet not has signed but not yet ratified the ICCPR. I know that Professor Alston has to teach during this hour, but somebody should convey to him later that there might be some hopeful signs, very tiny. You have to look very closely about ratification. So these are the two sort of pillars that I want to use to talk about UPR, because it shows that collectively, this is the Chinese government voluntarily taking on these kinds of obligations and opening itself to reporting, monitoring by independent expert bodies, of which Felice sits on one of the most important ones, I think, torture. So let's take a look at the UPR. Oh, I shouldn't have foxes up there. It's a problem of foxes, which is like foxes guarding the hen house. The UPR, what is it, and what has happened with China's UPRs? So this is basically what it is. In 2006, the General Assembly created the Human Rights Council to replace the old Human Rights Commission, the largely discredited Human Rights Commission, and gave it a mandate to conduct a comprehensive review of each of the UN member states at the time, 192, now 193, and it's a comprehensive review of all the human rights obligations and commitments. That means including under the treaty bodies, et cetera. And the basis of the review are basically three major documentation. One is the national report prepared by the member state. Secondly is the Office of the High Commissioner's compilation of UN information, including recommendations, concerns from the treaty bodies. And then finally, a summary of NGO reports. Then the whole process is supposed to include broad consultation with civil society. China's conducted now has undergone two, one in 2009 and one in 2013. I'm primarily going to focus on 2013 because the adoption of the final report for the 2013 review was adopted just last month. So this is a very timely discussion. So I'm focusing on 2013, and we'll look at that in a minute. Now, I want to set the tone to give you some insight into what the Chinese strategic tone is to engage in the UPR. And to do that, I wanted you to take a look at what Wu Hailong, the special envoy at the time and now the permanent representative, said in the opening statement at the beginning of the review. First, he said, look, we've accepted and implemented at least 42 of the recommendations from the first one, 2009, including death penalty reforms. We said we were going to reform RTL. We've done it. We've abolished it. We said we were going to cooperate with the special procedures, and we have invited them to come to visit China. The Working Group on Discrimination Against Women, they have come and gone, and we are now waiting for their report. We have China invited the experts on health, safe drinking water, and effects of foreign debt on human rights. Those visits are forthcoming. Then, to signal China's increased support with its resources, it announced in its opening statement in the review, we will now up how much money we donate to the High Commissioner's office. So they went from 50,000 to 800,000. So there was at the council when they announced this. Then they said, we will facilitate an early visit by the High Commissioner at a mutually convenient time. So this is the last, so the three parts of the strategic tone is we cooperate, secondly, we will support you with our extensive resources, and thirdly, this strategy is tor means they're just dragging it out and dragging it out, mutually convenient time, and when the current High Commissioner's mandate ends, will there be a mutually convenient time before the fall? Not really, it's the 25th anniversary of the crackdown in Tibet, the June 4th crackdown. I mean, it's not, I don't think they'll find a mutually convenient time. So here's just a quick look at 2009 versus 2003. Now, 2013, this is a little bit granular, but I think it's important to get some kind of a deep dive. So in 2009, the member states had to sign up. So 111 signed up, and the US, by the way, didn't even sign up, though it was an observer state. So of the 111 who signed up, only 60 countries got to speak because they were taking so much time. And of that, you see the final recommendations accepted, rejected. The most recommended recommendation was ICCPR ratification. Same thing in 2013. Almost the highest level was saying ratify the ICCPR. But this difference was because of a lot of unhappiness about the last procedure where most of the battles are fought, all 137 states who signed up got to speak, which means they each got 50 seconds to speak. And I know that the different delegations were like practicing. Oh, it's got to be faster. I'm running out of time. But they had 50 seconds. You can imagine what they can say in 50 seconds. Certainly more, you know, a lot less than what we can say in 10 minutes. So of the 137 governments, there were some pretty bizarre, you know, speaking governments who never spoke at the council, but they all signed up. Why? Because the new rule was every state that signed up got to speak. So you can imagine calling out the troops so that it would just make the division of the time down to 50 seconds. So there were 250 recommendations, and you can see some of the more controversial recommendations were like the ICC PR, more than 30 countries, RTL, 5 countries, freedom of expression, 15 plus countries, raising civil society, human rights defenders, and complying with UPR recs, more than 10, Tibet, Xinjiang, and ethnic minorities, 20 plus, et cetera. If you want to see a more granular analysis, you can go to our website. We've really analyzed it in more detail. And what we really see is that in some of the sensitive areas, more states were willing to both raise the sensitive issues as well as raise names. That was the big difference in 2013. Every single time that Cao Shunli, Xu Zhiyong's name was raised, you could see the very bad reaction from the Chinese delegation. Now, of these, I'm just going to quickly give you an example of the feeling of what was the Chinese government's responses to these recommendations. First of all, they accepted 165 of the 250 recommendations. So what kinds of accepted and already implementing ones? I'll give you one. Switzerland said, ensure that human rights defenders can exercise their legitimate activities, including participation in international mechanisms, without being subject to reprisals. And you know that this is exactly their final review. An adoption of the report took place exactly less than 1 week after Cao Shunli died in a military hospital. And they said, we've already implemented this recommendation. Secondly, being implemented, this was advanced by Australia, they said the recommendation was increase the transparency of traditional and social media by guaranteeing the rights of Chinese citizens to freely critique any state organ or functionary, and China's response was, we're already in the process of implementing that. Let me give you one example of a rejected recommendation. There were 48 rejected, and this one was rejected, was advanced by the US. And the rejected was, end the use of harassment, detention, arrest, and extrajudicial measures, such as enforced disappearance to control and silence human rights activists, as well as their family and friends. This recommendation was rejected. So not a big surprise, I think, to us in this discussion, that the UPR as a state-focused process determined by the states in which the outcome is simply the state under review gets to accept, reject, do, not do, and limit civil society participation. So this is why I call, there are three broad challenges of the UPR. So I'm going to wrap this. So one is the problem of foxes. Can we really trust foxes to watch other foxes to, you know, protect the hens like us? Like we're the hens. The second challenge is what I call the points of order challenge. And this is the very sophisticated maneuvering of procedural rules to control who can speak, what can be said, and how they say it. And more on that in a minute. The last challenge that I would just surface for discussion is what I call the shoes challenge. And this is because both at the Human Rights Council at the UPR and less than 2 weeks later at the General Assembly, Third Committee, the Chinese delegation said, in answer to concerns about the human rights problems in China, said, only the wearer of the shoes will know whether the shoe fits. In other words, only Chinese people can tell you. You can't tell us we're violating rights or there's a problem. So hence this problem, what I call the shoes problem. Because A, they're not the 1.2 billion people wearing the shoes. They're trying to speak for the people. And actually, on the Chinese Weibo space, lots of Weibo appropriations of this, saying many things about shoes. This is part of a broader push on NGOs, UN human rights mechanisms, which I know Felice will talk about, and it's a really serious pushback on universal values. Not a big surprise, because in the spring of 2013, document 9 of the General Office of the CPC said universal values is one of the 7 perils that we face to maintain the one-party system. Okay, point of order. This is just really important. At the review, after all the member states speak, the NGOs can now stand up and make what we call general comments under the rules. So one of the NGOs, ISHR, the International Service for Human Rights, used its 2 minutes, spoke for about a minute and a half, and then said, "We reserve our remaining time for a moment of silence for Cao Shunli and all the defenders who have died." China jumped up and said, "Point of order. The rules only permit general comments. Silence is not a comment." Okay, so this then provokes a very almost Twilight Zone debate about the interpretation of general comments. And so the president said, "This is a very complex legal issue." And he says, "I defer this to Bureau, Legal Bureau for Determination." China said, "No, we demand a ruling." And so then a big, you know, lots of chaos, you know, and they said, "Are we ruling on whether silence is speech? Are we ruling on whether the president has the authority to rule? Like, what are we ruling on?" And then this is all chaos. You can watch all this blow by blow on our YouTube channel, because we recorded the whole proceedings and you can watch it. So what was the outcome? The outcome was, after the president, you know, said, "We're going to proceed," and China said, "No, you can't proceed, because you must make them stop not talking." So this is going. So this gets worse and worse, and then they proceed, and they, you know, they kind of not talk because it took so long, and while they were not talking, the moment of silence had kind of passed. So then when the fourth NGO down is the International Federation of Human Rights, the 国际人权联盟. We are one of the, Human Rights in China is one of the 170 member states. So the FIDH got up to speak, and in its 2 minutes, it says, "On behalf of our member leagues, the International Campaign for Tibet, and Human Rights in China, point of order." And it was like, "What?" And China said, "We wish for clarification. What are the, is the speaker accredited?" And they are. They're like a 100-year-old French league. And so the secretary, they convene and they talk, you know, and the president says, "Yes, they are ECOSOC accredited." Okay, so then they proceed. China interrupts again. "Point of order. Are the referenced NGOs," we're kind of like Voldemort, they never say our name, you know? So they say, "Are the referenced NGOs accredited?" And then there's a little consultation, you know, which they knew the answer because they blocked our accreditation twice. So they asked the question anyway. So then the secretary said, "Yes, indeed, the referenced NGOs are not ECOSOC accredited." Then China said, "You cannot reference a non-ECOSOC accredited NGO in a statement by an accredited NGO." So this is a very important point, that when Martin Flaherty said this morning, "Let's engage and try to explore non-threatening engagement," good God, silence became very threatening. And I think this is an indication of the incredible need to control civil society voices. And you'll see on our website, we posted all the statements of the governments who, to their credit, stood up and said things like, "In English, we have an expression, silence can speak volumes," you know. And then some other, you know, states said, "It is very important that at the Human Rights Council, no state should be able to tell an NGO what to say and how to say it." So I think a number of these, you know, the UK, Ireland, Germany was really good. Sadly, the US, because it was exactly the time of Michelle Obama's trip to China, the voice was a bit muted, but then it was quite embarrassing when the debate got ridiculous, and then, you know, the US came in with a slightly stronger statement. So these are challenges to civil society that is extremely important, and it's part of a broader challenge, and this is a part of a broader challenge, including like-minded countries. Now, I didn't make this up. This is what they call themselves. So these include like Pakistan, China, you see the list, Russia, Cuba, you know, Uganda, you know, Iran, and they have signed most recently an open letter to the president of the Human Rights Council, and they want greater transparency about NGOs to counter politically motivated acts, and they want a full list of accreditation to be made available to delegations. This is very chilling, very threatening, very intimidating. So I hope that Felice will speak more about it from the perspective of an, you know, as an independent expert. So we're left with the UPR. It's imperfect, it's politicized, it's dominated by geopolitical power dynamics and interests, but this is the one global, international human rights platform that we have. And I think from our experience, it is very important to not cede the field. It is very important for civil society to be there, particularly since Chinese civil society are demanding the right to participate in it. So this is why, if they are demanding the right to participate in it, we need to be there to open up that space and make it safe and make it possible for them to participate. Because at the end of the day, this somewhat circus at times, in my most cynical moments, but at other moments, that there's a possibility to push for little baby steps forward, because this is the best we've got right now, is that at the end of the day, fortunately, this is not the main event, because this is the main event. And this is a picture you see of Ding Zilin, who is one of the speakers, main spokespersons for the Tiananmen mothers for 25 years, just asking for an investigation, accountability, and compensation to the victims. You see in the middle, these were the original hunger strikers in Heilongjiang that is now gathering lots of steam with lawyers protecting them. You're also seeing the street movements. And on the top here, you see Cao Shunli. We have created a whole advocacy site for her on our site so that her legacy, that denial of medical attention and pulling it out 4 or 5 months till she died will not succeed. And her issues of greater transparency and participation of Chinese citizens in international human rights reporting will live on. So I didn't have enough time to introduce you to all this stuff, but please visit our site and support human rights in China lowercase, and do support us. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. Sharon has just demonstrated one of the key things you have to understand about China in multilateral bodies when it comes to human rights, and that is that procedure is substance. I'm going to say a few words first about China's overall approach to human rights in the United Nations bodies, and then I'm going to talk a little about the special rapporteurs and the treaty bodies. And one of the things that's significant, really quite significant, is that China now accepts the universality of human rights. It hosted a world conference, it signed 6 treaties, it has put human rights in its own constitution. They announced at the Universal Periodic Review in Geneva that they donate $800,000 annually to the High Commissioner's Office for support of human rights activities. We don't know yet what they are, but we're working on it. This was the first time this was publicly stated. They received a human rights high commissioner in the past. Why, Mary Robinson was there 6 times or 7 times, and Louise Arbour was there 2x. But as I'll describe, that has not been a successful kind of engagement. Now, China accepts universality, but it defines it differently. Now, Jerry Cohn said that what country wouldn't, if it has an opportunity to identify what universality means? Well, China's concept is one that supports relativism, that every country has a right to its own model of development when it comes to economic, social, and cultural rights, and every country can pursue all the other rights in accordance with its own model, its history, its culture, its wishes. So the standard for human rights is not a universal standard, is it? The standard for human rights is on a sliding scale. That's what relativism means. China's experience has been to prioritize economic and social rights and solidarity rights, the so-called third generation rights, like the right to peace, the right to a just international economic order, and so forth, over civil and political rights. And this is very much exemplified by China's questioning of other countries in the UPR process. Every other country in the world has shown up for this Universal Periodic Review process. And China
as part of its commitment to human rights, asks questions at these sessions. But the questions are almost invariably questions about economic social rights, women or children, except now and then, if they get a Denmark in there that's been, or a Norway in there, they'll say, what are you doing to allow civil political organizations to participate in your report, or they'll put some kind of question like that, which is, of course, a bit galling. Since when they're asked that question, they declare that it's the sovereign right of every state to determine how it makes its own report and what the process is. In fact, they even wrote a letter this year condemning the High Commissioner for Human Rights because she did a survey. She asked states how they carry out their reporting obligations. What process do you use? And the response of China was to condemn the High Commissioner for interfering in the sovereign rights of states to determine how they do their own reports. They didn't answer the survey. Now, China also generally opposes the individual human rights paradigm, and I've described the right to development, solidarity rights, right to self-determination, and so forth. That fits in with that approach, and has a strong commitment to the idea that duties limit rights, and that the prerequisite for the enjoyment of rights is stability. So that when the UN's Commission of Inquiry on North Korea, which was convened in the last year, carried out its work, China's criticism of it at the Human Rights Council was that it was creating tensions. The tensions would undermine stability. Therefore, the Commission of Inquiry, which was approved during the year China was not on the Human Rights Council, was illegitimate. Now, what else does China do? It prioritizes cooperation over compliance. It generally opposes country-specific resolutions at the Council. This came out of self-protection beginning in the years after Tiananmen. But they also protect others by opposing all country-specific resolutions. Or if the resolution is adopted by consensus, they vote along with it, and then they stand up and say they dissociate themselves from it. Of course, the fact that China votes in favor of resolutions condemning the United States or drones or something that's distinctly U.S. Oriented, and that China votes for resolutions against Israel, doesn't seem to trouble them, that it's out of sync with this general opposition to the idea of country-specific resolutions. China also works to limit treaty bodies in every way possible, to limit information sources, especially NGOs. And should those NGOs have a name like Human Rights in China or have the word Tibet in their title, they're particularly problematic. And China has come to treaty bodies like the Committee Against Torture and demanded that those NGOs not be received, that their information not be circulated, that the information not be posted on the websites, and now they've gone so far in the UN treaty strengthening process to demand that such information not be discussed or raised unless the state itself first approves that those things can be raised. Well, the rest of the countries haven't gone along with that last point. But you can understand that they're pushing, and when it's an open door and there's no resistance from other states, they keep pushing, and they really come up with these very creative procedural arguments for limiting forms of information. They also want to limit membership, who are members of the committees, how they're selected, the independence of the committees by instructing them about working methods and, as I said, even the questions asked. And they've gone so far in the last year, especially since the review at the Committee Against Torture, to demand a code of conduct for all treaty body members, which basically means it's a that one shouldn't have any conflict of interest, that one shouldn't benefit from the positions that one holds, that one shouldn't that there should be an accountability mechanism, and it goes beyond that. Now, China's general approach is in the UN do not politicize human rights by finger-pointing, i.e., don't talk about specific countries and certainly don't talk about specific cases within specific countries. Now, the example Sharon gave us about even challenging an NGO, mentioning the fact that another organization is an affiliate, is an example of how this control of information and groups is carried out. Now, the problem with China is really well, it was really well expressed by Stephanie Klein-Albrand, who used to work at the High Commissioner's office and who wrote about it in our, Kristen Broeker and I edited a new book on the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. In there, Stephanie says, the High Commissioner, Mary Robinson, could not choose to ignore China, nor could she engage on China's terms. So her approach as High Commissioner was to initiate a two-pronged strategy of systematically raising human rights problems with the government, while at the same time engaging in a technical cooperation program to help improve the human rights situation. I'll bring you to the end of the book, or the end of the chapter, which is it failed, and those programs were closed down. Even though Robinson had visited China seven times, combining both public and private criticism with the authorities with engagement on issues of concern, nothing was achieved, and there was this sense that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, as gatekeeper, was keeping anybody else in the society from engaging. Now, current High Commissioner for Human Rights, Nave Pillay, was invited by the High Commissioner as was invited by China as the first country to invite her to come. Not meeting her conditions for a visit, she hasn't gone yet. But we do understand that this spring, there will be such a visit. We don't know exactly when. It's coming up. I was asked to talk about the special procedures and the treaty bodies, and I'm probably already out of time, but I'll just say if I have a few minutes.
Just 3 minutes.
Okay, in 3 minutes. Special procedures. There are 50 special procedures, special rapporteurs, independent experts that examine either thematic issues or country-specific matters in the United Nations. That's a lot. Phil Boston's been rapporteur two, three times, going to be again very shortly. 50 rapporteurs, 75 people with working groups, not one has ever been a Chinese national. Compare this to the treaty bodies. They're members of six treaty bodies. On four of the treaty bodies, they have members. Those members have all been former diplomats, although currently they claim that they are heads of NGOs. They have all, every one of them has had a major diplomatic position. And the appointment and the running for candidacy on the Committee Against Torture began when the Committee Against Torture, before my time, said that the report that was submitted was inadequate. Procedure becomes substance, and substance becomes the way things are followed. Sharon told you a bit about how the who's been invited and who hasn't been invited, and this whole issue of cooperation. So I'll just say a few words about the treaty strengthening process. Again, what is going on there? It's a process called the treaty strengthening process by the High Commissioner, but by those of us who watch what's been happening, and especially what's gone on with the governments involved, it's really a treaty weakening process. And the goal here is to limit the independence, to limit what the treaty bodies can do. China's position has been that there is a burden of reporting, that treaty bodies have to stay within their mandate, that they have to limit the information sources, that NGOs that present information need to be accredited, they can't be general civil society organizations, and that states should play a larger role in the method of work, including this issue of a code of conduct that I spoke about. Now, the way they do this is really quite interesting. Committee Against Torture adopted a new procedure by necessity, which is a list of issues prior to reporting. Normally, a state would present a report, the committee would review the report, and prepare a list of issues based on the report, and then send that to the country, which would then come in person and engage in a discussion, question and answer about that list of issues. Not enough translation, not enough time, no money. The Committee Against Torture said, let's do the list of issues before the report. We've had the prior report. We have materials. We're sentient beings. We can identify those issues in advance. So we came up with a list of issues prior to reporting. Country comes in with a response to that. It's great for bureaucrats. People love it. Everybody's happy with it. We posted these lists of issues on our website, and we said, states, you can adopt this new procedure. China immediately said they would reject it. And so far we have, I think, China, Venezuela, Cuba, and Belarus have rejected this procedure. China went a step further. They said, you've got to take this document off the website. And it was not a decision of the committee, but for some reason this item disappeared from the UN list of issues prior to reporting website. I have the document if any of you are interested in seeing it. It's a public document. It was adopted in a public session by a committee and all that. But the goal here is, why get rid of a list of issues prior to reporting? Because it named names. It had follow-up on particular cases. It asked what happened to this person, to that person, and the other person. Everyone from Houdia to Chen Guangchen to... it just had everything in it. And it said, what's happened? And it raised these questions in a way that obviously was too much for a UN website to hold. What should be done in response to all of this? I think we need to focus on, within the UN context, prioritizing compliance over cooperation, using a case approach rather than generalities in United Nations exchanges. Promoting transparency, this LOIPR, list of issues prior to reporting, I just described to you is a perfect example of that. Sharon can tell you about the webcast of the Disability Rights Committee, NGOs webcast the committees, and China quietly went in and harassed the secretariat. At least that's what the secretariat said to me, that they did not want this to be permitted. These are public sessions, but they didn't want it to be webcast without their permission. Transparency can be valuable, and we ought to be pushing for it. We ought to also watch efforts for overall reform as opposed to piecemeal. Sometimes you can get further in the UN with reforming one little thing than trying to reform everything, because when you try to reform everything, you may have a setback. The role of leadership, we're not seeing enough leadership. We're not seeing enough leadership from states. We're not seeing enough leadership from the Secretary General, the High Commissioners, and others where the Chinese are concerned. And we need to encourage accountability mechanisms that are self-regulation, not regulation from the foxes guarding the chicken coop. Finally, the issue of independence of mechanisms. We need to maintain the independence of the mechanisms, and we need to ensure that the election procedures bring us really outstanding members who can, in fact, be independent. What you don't want to do is let a UPR, Universal Periodic Review, process become the basis for turning independent mechanisms like the special procedures and the treaty bodies into essentially state-run entities. You want to be sure that however much you think the treaty bodies socialize states into thinking about treaty compliance, that's Ryan's great contribution to talk about how that has happened. But however much you think that they do socialize states, you have to make sure that these mechanisms work for everybody, not just for the ones in the middle. Beth Simmons says the treaty bodies work for those in the middle, not for the really bad ones, and the really good ones don't need it. If these mechanisms are going to last, they have to work for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Richardson.
How much time do I have?
10 minutes.
Okay. I'm going to try to be even more succinct than that. Thank you very much for having me. It's a dubious honor to be the last speaker of the day. I also can only assume that I have somehow deeply irked Sharon, given that she's given me a subject to talk about this afternoon that she knows drives me nuts, which is the subject of bilateral human rights dialogues. And maybe one way you can think about this in the back of your heads as we talk about this is, if you did the same thing more than 100 times with a view towards making some kind of change and no change eventuated, would you keep doing it? So keep that in the back of your head. Japan has had 7 rounds of human rights dialogues. The Australians have had 15. I'm so sorry Philip left. I would have loved to engage him in debate in Australia's role in international human rights promotion. The US has had 18 rounds since 1990 or 1991. There's some debate about that. Harold's here. UK has had 20 rounds, and the institution that I think Sharon and I both hold dearest to our hearts in the promotion of human rights in China, the EU, has now had 32 rounds of human rights dialogues since 1995. I want to make one important foundation, what to me is a foundational point about these exercises before we unpack them a little bit, which is that I think as both Sharon and Felice have illustrated, you know, over the last 20 years, the Chinese government has really at an international political and diplomatic level sought to contain and confine discussions about human rights and to try to only have those behind closed doors. And that for the most part, other governments particularly, and here I'm speaking particularly about the ones that have had these kinds of dialogues, have treated human rights issues in China as an issue to be managed, but not necessarily to be solved. I don't in any way mean to denigrate or disrespect the many, many, many diplomats who have worked incredibly hard and done incredibly brave things in incredibly difficult circumstances to help people. But in this particular vehicle of the dialogues, which really arose to some extent from the ashes of the Human Rights Commission, this vehicle has left a lot to be desired, in part because it has allowed the Chinese government essentially to confine these kinds of discussions out of the public view. And I think for a lot of the other governments, it has been something to do. It has been an exercise. And it has not necessarily accomplished much change. And I think that's important to keep in mind. The way the dialogues are structured varies enormously. When it goes well for most governments, the expectation is that there will be 2 rounds a year, typically one inside China and one outside. How often they happen in and of itself has become a real subject of debate and difficulty. Often, if things are not going well in a particular bilateral relationship, one of the first things that will get shoved to the side or it will become very difficult to schedule is a round of a human rights dialogue. We have watched some of these terrific diplomats who could be spending their time doing lots of other more useful things in our view, trying to chase down their counterparts at the MFA and get commitments to dates for particular rounds so that they can try to organize the agenda and who will be speaking on certain subjects. The agendas of the dialogues themselves are no less difficult to sort out. They are jointly determined by the Chinese side and by the other government in question, and they are, in theory, arranged or structured on the principle of equality, meaning that there's supposed to be equal time devoted to discussing how a particular human rights issue plays out inside China and in the United States, or in China and in Australia, or in China and the EU. And look, as someone from an organization that obviously takes the concept of universality of human rights fairly seriously, in principle, we have no argument with this. And often, you know, I find in discussing human rights issues with Chinese diplomats or government officials that as an American, I happen to be one, that talking about the work that my organization does on the U.S. is a very helpful way of making for a much more functional conversation. At the same time, there are some circumstances in which this idea of equality, I think, really gets deeply distorted either because it suggests that there's some kind of equivalency between the human rights situation in, say, Norway and in China, which, quite simply, there's just not. But I think it also can be effectively a waste of time and resources that could be better spent digging deep into certain kinds of issues, again, inside China. There are now a number of, for lack of a better term, subsidiary dialogues. There are ones that focus, for example, on the rule of law specifically. There is now at least one that focuses on women's rights. There are at least two governments have labor rights dialogues. There are also add-ons to the dialogues. Sharon and I have both participated in the seminar that was attached to, is attached to, it's a little unclear what its fate is these days, that was attached to the official EU-China human rights dialogue. Who participates in these things? Typically, sort of the frontline people are diplomats and government officials, usually from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, International Organizations Department, and then their counterparts from the other government in question. They're usually officials pertaining to whatever the other issue is in question. For example, if there's going to be a discussion about police abuses, for example, there will be representatives from the PSB or the MOJ in China, there will be people from the DOJ in the US. Depending on, again, the subjects and how everybody's feeling, there are sometimes academics or other kinds of experts who are invited to join. I know there are a number of people here today who are welcome to comment on this. Some dialogues do make an attempt to include both Gongo and independent NGO representatives and sometimes international NGOs or NGOs that function in whatever the other country is. This was sort of standard practice for a number of governments from the beginning. It is much less the case now. It's become very fraught having that kind of participation. And arguably one of our greatest criticisms of the dialogues is that they really are out of the reach of lots of civil society activists inside China. You know, discussions that you know, arguably pertain most to them are very difficult for them to access or in some circumstances even really know about. What's the quality of the discussion? Again, I invite commentary from people here who've participated in these. They range, I think, occasionally from the great to the frustrating. I think they're often frustrating, and there's not really much of a real exchange of views, to the positively surreal. That is the only polite way to describe at least one of the ones I sat in on. The variables range from where the dialogue is being held, and it's not necessarily always the case that the ones outside China are better than the ones inside. It depends enormously on the personalities sitting around the table. It depends on the state of bilateral relations. It very much, I think, varies according to what topic is being discussed. It's much harder, I think, to have an effective, meaningful conversation about individual cases of torture than it is to have a discussion about the importance of disability rights and how to respect those. So it can be very hard, I think, to construct one of these exercises within the framework of government-to-government relations and really have them be effective. There are very few governments that even say they have benchmarks in order to move on to another round. So there's no agreement that a certain situation has to improve, that somebody has to be let out of prison, that a law needs to advance, that a certain case needs to be resolved before the next round is meant to be held. The EU has said that it has benchmarks. I have yet to see that piece of paper. And if those benchmarks do in fact exist, I can only assume that they are very, very low indeed. Usually after the dialogues, the Chinese side will issue a fairly perfunctory statement, simply saying that the dialogue has taken place with a little bit of basic information about the location and the date. There's almost never any information about either what got discussed, and there's certainly no information if anything problematic or difficult got discussed. Some governments have gotten, I think, much better and more consistent in saying after their dialogues what got discussed and to some extent how it went. Mike Posner was very good about this, Ozra Zeya. The US has been better about this, I think, in the last couple of years. A couple of other governments aren't terribly consistent, but when they do it, I think it's helpful, partly because then we all get to know, and most important, Chinese activists themselves get to know what got discussed. Just as a quick description of one of the most recent rounds of the EU dialogue, which took place last year, to us, it represented a whole new low for this exercise. It was held in Guiyang. It was only about 6 hours. The fight about simultaneous versus consecutive translation didn't get resolved until the last couple of hours, which meant that most of the exercise was just waiting for translation. And there was no press at all. And what we said about that dialogue afterwards was that it was precisely the kind of dialogue that the Chinese government likes best, away from senior Chinese officials, away from the international press, and with little ambition from either side to apply rights protections to real life situations in China. And I think the critique that we summarized there about the nature of the dialogues now summarizes really the debate right now, which is that with each successive round, the Chinese government feels less obliged to make changes while the EU accepts progressively more restrictive conditions for even holding the dialogue. It'll be interesting to see how this plays out under the Xi Jinping administration. There haven't been many rounds yet. But I think arguably the biggest criticism is that it's very hard to see how these discussions have contributed significantly to any of the progress that we have seen. You know, it's very hard to connect the dots between anything, even collectively across different governments, that was said about narrowing the scope of the death penalty or abolishing RTL, right? It's very hard to attribute credit to those bilateral exchanges in making those kinds of improvements. So with all of that said, I've had diplomats say to me, why is a human rights organization opposed to dialogue? We're not opposed to dialogue. And at the end of the day, if the best that comes out of these exchanges is that, you know, foreign government officials and Chinese government officials spend a day debating these issues, even if there's no agreement, it's our view that that's better than not doing it. I actually think that we're never really going to know the answer to this question, but there's much to be said for remembering that you can't necessarily know the motivations and the interests of the other people sitting in the room, and that as optimists, I think there is merit in trying to express concerns and trying to share views about these different issues across the table on a regular basis. So in that sense, we've never called for dialogues to be canceled. We have a lot of views about how they can be improved and strengthened. You know, one of the real problems that we've watched a lot of governments struggle with is that not only is it that the dialogues become a deliverable in and of themselves, simply the having of one. Doesn't matter if it's good, doesn't matter if it has consequences, it's just the having of it becomes the goal, right? And that's not, you know, especially given the state of human rights in China, that's not sufficient. What we really need people to be doing is talking about particular cases, about the facts, and getting responses from those. The dialogues also have the effect of preventing other parts of any given government from feeling an obligation or a need to raise human rights issues. I think I'm going to use an American example here just because it's the one I know the best. I think some of the best American diplomacy in the last 4 or 5 years on human rights has been undertaken by some of the unusual suspects, some of the people who you wouldn't necessarily expect to have been tasked with carrying a human rights message. And I think that sends a signal to the Chinese government that the whole of the US government is concerned, or not just one part of the State Department, or not just the State Department. But I've also had people from other parts of the US government say, oh my God, I don't want to have to talk about human rights issues with my Chinese counterparts in any way. We have dialogue. Isn't that the right place to do it? And I think that's it's very counterproductive, but it's also very hard effectively to surmount. And I think that's one of the real challenges of these exercises. I think ultimately it is our view that effective advocacy on human rights issues with the Chinese government requires being polite, it requires being public, and it requires being prosecutorial, and really focusing on the facts and asking for explanations about why, for example, Liu Xia can't leave her apartment, or what it was Liu Xiaobo did that purportedly rose to the level of being a threat to the state, and that asking those kinds of questions, whether inside or outside the dialogue, is good, but they can't be asked only inside the dialogue, right? So not only do we need to see a greater diversity of government officials ask questions like this outside the framework of a dialogue, I think to make a dialogue more effective, there should also be benchmarks to move to subsequent rounds. Again, if you'd been doing it 100 times, nothing had changed. I think you have to ask yourself about the utility of the practice. The last point that I want to make is that, especially in light of the extraordinary rise of civil society inside China, whether it's people who are teacher Ne or teacher Y, right? I think governments need to make sure that they are giving equal amounts of dialogue time to the right people. I think we're at a point in time now where there are lots of civil society voices who deserve as much, if not more, recognition in these discussions as people who serve in an unrepresentative, unelected government. And I think credentialing those kinds of views and engaging those kinds of perspectives is extremely important. So I'm going to take a little tiny twist on what you said a moment ago and suggest that maybe it should be we prioritize compliance and cooperate with those who want to improve human rights. I will stop there. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. So with Harold's indulgence, this panel started a few minutes late, so we're going to give Ryan his 10 minutes nonetheless, because he's carefully sat there, and I, for one, want to know why, despite everything we've heard, China is being socialized. Go ahead, Ryan, convince me.
Thanks for the cue. I was actually going to take my cue also from Felice's last remarks to say that I do agree that the human rights regime, in a certain sense, is not worth the candle if we don't have an answer to improving the practices of the most repressive states. So in my own writing, I'm now thinking about, in part, with respect to this question, political scientists that tell us that we should give up on the most repressive states and focus on the ones in the middle. And because the panel has focused so much on what international influences could be brought to bear on China and the centerpiece being compliance, I thought I would wear one of my hats, which is the interdisciplinary hat, and the way in which I think through some of these questions from political science and international relations scholarship and studies of the prospects for states changing their human rights behaviors. But the first question, I thought, is what we might learn from China's practices outside of the realm of human rights. One of my favorite books in political science and international relations is by Alistair Ian Johnson called Social States, focusing, by happenstance, it's one of my favorite books, but on China. And he demonstrates empirically ways in which China has changed its practices in the arms control regime because of a concept, in large part a concept of being a responsible major power. And the engagement of the Foreign Service in Vienna and elsewhere is the way in which they have been socialized, or one could say a form of social influence. And the take-home point for me from the book are twofold. One, that international forces are important. The ways in which China thinks of itself as a member in the international community can be an important driver for social change within society, and in fact might even be a quicker link, because it's not democratic, between what maybe happens in Vienna and in Geneva and The Hague to the center than democratic countries. That's part of what Johnson tells us, that international influences and membership and status within the international community is important. And the second take-home lesson is that China and other states will adopt these international norms many a times under certain conditions, one might say, even when it's against their interests. So part of his study demonstrates that the PLA would be opposed to the concessions that are being made at the international level, but they're not the ones that are engaging at the international level, so they're not susceptible to that social influence. So it's an optimistic story of social change happening top down from the international community through to societies, in this particular instance, a case study of arms control. So the question is human rights another arena in which these kinds of influences could take place? I'm thinking in significant part about Martin Flaherty's comments at the first panel, where he said, you know, one model, one approach is the Trojan horse approach, in which outsiders approach China through, and the Chinese government, non-threatening forms of legal engagement. And in a certain sense, I think Johnson's book says, actually, it could be threatening forms of engagement. If the international expectations are, in fact, not fitting for what the current administration in China thinks are within its functional demands, it actually still can work because there are other outside influences. So that's the question, what we learn from other policy areas. Second question is what our model of social action is. So taking a cue from Sharon's presentation, where the screen showed civil society actors, and the second panel of today's discussion discussed the rise of civil society. One question is whether or not the rise of civil society is a precondition for change on the human rights front, if it is the main event. But instead, maybe international influences could also be a part of that event, or at least be the jumpstart that can take place even without, counterintuitively, even without local social movements. So in political science, we're very used to, say, in some ways, a dominant school of thought is called the spiral model. So anybody in this room who's self-selected into this room based on your interest in human rights is probably familiar with Margaret Keck and Catherine Sicking's work on transnational advocacy networks, Rhys Robin Sicking's great book on the power of human rights. Their model assumes that international social movements have to interact with local social movements to bring change, especially in repressive societies. But I think that there's another paradigm or school of thought that's empirically well, rigorously defended, called the World Society School, otherwise called the Stanford School, which can actually show global transformative change and diffusion of state practices around the world, even when you don't have a local social movement calling for it. Now, admittedly, what you often get then is a gap between certain kinds of commitments and actual practices on the ground, but that's what I mean by a jump start to more meaningful change. And those studies take place in human rights. They also take place in the environmental movements. And you have counterintuitive findings, for example, a study in the Latin America, which talks about the diffusion of statutes and provisions and bureaucracies for domestic violence against women. And the modal category of states that adopt these norms are ones that do not have a meaningful women's rights group within the country. So really kind of profound ways to challenge our thinking. And one vehicle for this might be, for China in particular, the creation of an NHRI, because it could link it into a regional network, and that might be the form in which this would take place, and with like the Asia-Pacific National Human Rights Institutions. The third point I wanted to make is more also in an optimistic vein. Part of what the panel discussed, it seemed to me, was also China's human rights policy towards others. And I want to think a little bit more about that and the ways in which China's foreign policy might also be brought back home in a kind of a social influence way. So the idea is maybe it's a good thing that China sits on the Human Rights Council and then reviews others. So to think about what China's role will be in reviewing others, not the subject of UPRs, which is kind of a funny thing to think about, because part of the reason that the commission was abandoned was because bad actors got to be on the commission or chaired the commission, like Libya got to chair it, or Sudan was elected to the Human Rights Commission when the United States was knocked off. But the idea is that maybe having a seat in these chambers is a good thing. It's a good thing because maybe China then starts to think human rights rhetoric is less threatening. They have an inflated sense of the power or effect of human rights. Maybe it's a good thing because of bureaucratization. The first panel, at least this morning, talked about lawyers, and the second panel as well, lawyers in China being an important influence. Well, if an increasing part of the state is bureaucratized towards lawyers and human rights lawyers to actually understand and be able to be powerful within these institutional bodies, maybe that's a positive. And the other is, of course, the network effects that might take place by being embedded in global institutions or in the United Nations with other actors, in which it means that China has to step forward and make certain kinds of statements like, oh, we give open invitations to special rapporteurs. And what I want to invoke there is the work of a political scientist at Dartmouth, also one of my favorite bodies of work is by him. His name is Brian Greenhill, and he shows how the ways in which we think of social networks that apply to human behavior at the individual level, like you end up voting the way that the community votes within your neighborhood or your workplace, and you also end up gaining and losing weight according to how your friends increase and decrease in weight. He actually studies states as the unit of analysis and demonstrates that there are these kinds of social network effects. So with that, the last point I wanted to wonder about or think about is the potential for perverse effects, also based on these network effects. And the question is, what is the impact for the human rights regime by increasing China's participation? So one of the goals, of course, that we think about is getting China to actually ratify the ICCPR. But what might be the perverse effects for human rights norms based on China's getting a seat at that table? And what I mean by that are a few things. First, it's difficult to imagine a larger gap between practice and obligation when a state would join the ICCPR. Now, that's actually just a feature of human rights law that I think is different than many other parts of international law when we think about compliance, because actually when states start to ratify, they're generally not in compliance at the point of ratification. But China's a pretty sizable gap in the substance. And it's also going to be a pretty sizable gap in terms of the procedure. So if procedure is substance, flouting the rules, trying to change the rules with respect to the treaty bodies, that might be a concern. Also, membership on the committee itself, what that might mean for the Human Rights Committee. I really do mean to raise this as a question. It's not like I have an answer to that and I'm trying to suggest my answer or smuggle it in. It's an open question in my mind. And then the last one is just the fact that we're given that China gives is saying that it's giving $800,000 to the Office of the High Commissioner on an annual basis. With money comes power. So what are the potential negative effects that might happen to the regime once China itself is changing, but it also changes the regime by its participation?
Thank you very much. So we have 5 minutes for your questions. Way in the back. Yeah, we'll gather a few questions so to maximize the number of questions.
My name is Ting Wong. I just want to thank all the panelists and the program today. I understand that most international human rights organizations focus on the plight of the downtrodden, the poor, and the needy. But I wonder if in the case of China, that there are other groups that are underserved or overlooked. I'm thinking of the most powerful and the most wealthy people in China. The discussion of spillover effects this morning helped me understand and realize that the absence of human rights protection in China is definitely helping to drive up Manhattan real estate prices. My neighbor, who is a real estate agent, says that in the last several years, there are enormous numbers of wealthy Chinese people coming to Manhattan to buy property. For the most part, these people do not speak English. They have very little intention of actually living here, but they are concerned that should they be persecuted in China, that they would have a safe haven. So these people are, in a very real sense, moving with their feet, voting with their feet. The story gets even worse for the really senior officials like Zhou Yongkang, which we talked about earlier this morning. By all accounts, he's in very dire straits.
Can you get to a question, please?
He is held incommunicado detention. So my question to the panel is, when you write reports about human rights conditions in China and raise issues with government leaders and NGOs, in addition to Liu Xiaobo and Xu Zhiyong, could you also mention Zhou Yongkang and Wang Lijun and the vice chairman of the Central Military Commission, who was just dragged out of his hospital bed 2 weeks ago for corruption charges? When the top leaders deny human rights to themselves, it is very hard for them to grant human rights to others. Over the last 30 years, the development of the rule of law in China came as a result of the Cultural Revolution, when the ruling elite suffered from the lack of rights.
Now they are backsliding. Okay.
Sorry.
Your person next to you has a question, hopefully quicker.
I'll make it very quick. My name's Michael McCullough. I'm with the Department of Foreign Affairs in Canada. I'm also a professor of human rights at the Norman Patterson School of International Affairs. Sophie, when you talked about the importance of when you talked about dialogues and human rights dialogues, Canada was one of the countries in 2006 we canceled our dialogue because we were seeing the issues being confined to the dialogue behind closed doors. And it was taking us 2 months to prepare for the darn things. We put our efforts instead into convening civil society, Chinese activists, human rights defenders, lawyers. We found that to be much more useful in terms of outcomes. But the piece that I want to pick up and ask you a question is, with the UPR, we don't want to recreate the dialogue, but we do want to take it outside of the chambers of the Human Rights Council. So this month, we'll be meeting with Chinese officials to look at the commitments they've made, not to create a dialogue, but to have something that's fact-based, to try and promote some notion of accountability. And it's something that's quick and easy for us. We don't have to spend months. What are your thoughts on taking the UPR outside of the council chambers?
Okay, one more question up here in the front, and we'll have to cut it off there. I'm sorry.
Quick. Yeah. Alvin Chung, LL.M student. A friendly amendment, which is to say that there is some involvement in the international human rights field through the Hong Kong and Macau Special Administrative Regions and their respective joint declarations and the ICCPR. But what we've seen is that even in those fora, there are endless arguments. For instance, in relation to Hong Kong, is the reservation to Article 25 valid? So my question goes back to the unusual suspects, and I want to posit the role of other unusual suspects, the private sector. And there is limited understanding of the extent to which the ICCPR is being infringed even in the SARs, and to what extent can we encourage the private sector and get the message through to China that money talks?
Okay, you have 30 seconds to answer those questions, guys. Whoever wants to tackle one of them, at
can
least.
Can I do private sector?
Private sector, yeah.
Can I do private sector?
Go.
Start with the private sector, quick.
I'll be the unlikely respondent to the unlikely suspect's question, which is private sector. I think, Alvin, that's a very important question. And the short answer in terms of a private sector initiative that implicates freedom of expression and privacy in the internet space, it's the Global Network Initiative, of which Human Rights in China and Human Rights Watch are two of the founding NGOs. This is going into the eighth year. And I think that's an example of it's an iterative process. It has taken a very long time to develop an independent mechanism, but it builds very much on the UN principles on human rights obligations of business and other, et cetera, et cetera. And now there's a working group on the human rights obligations of business, and that working group is now going into its almost third year. So I think there's work being done in the space, and we in the human rights, rule of law, governance space needs to do more building on those initiatives.
Anyone wants to address the rights of oligarchs, for example?
We have a question from Watson, who's Chinese speaking, we'll have to translate.
Okay, very quick. One last question that may not be answered.
My name is Hua Ze. I'm a human rights activist from China. I can't speak English, so I need a translator. 就是我今天跟我朋友校史，我们都是这个许志勇的同事，我们是新公民运动的很重要的参与者，就是我们都知道新公民这个案件系列案件，之前1月22号许志勇就他第一审开庭了，然后我们得到的消息，他会在就是2个星期之内会二审宣判，但是不会开庭了。 然后新公民案的其他的两个很重要的这个参与者，就是丁佳喜和赵长青，他们会在这个月的8号和10号分别开庭。然后新公民案的其他的两个很重要的这个参与者，就是丁佳喜和赵长青，他们会在这个月的8号和10号分别开庭。所以这个接下来会是一个非常密集的开庭的过程。对，所以我们就是不知道怎么样才能让国际上能够持续的关注，在做那么多法律的专家，有没有可能从这个法律的角度来对更多的关注，比如说来分析这个案件，因为他们是以这个扰乱公共秩序罪被审判的，但是实际上我们都知道他们的是因为政治的权利，比如说自由的表达、集会，所以呢，这个对我不知道能不能从这个角度有更多的关注。讲到刚才，因为之前都讲到了这个中国的维稳的机制，中国这些政府用这个很强大的这个财政的这个掠夺这个人民的这个财富，然后或者就是建立了很强大的这个维稳机制。
I will defer to your better Mandarin than my Cantonese Mandarin.
Okay, no, my name is Hua Ze, and with the Xiao Shu, I'm working for the New Citizens Movement. I mean, we've been quite active, and you might know that on January 22nd, Xu Zhiyong has been sentenced to 4 years, and his appeal trial, which won't be an open trial, is going to take place next week. Other important members of this movement are going to be tried in the next few weeks. As this is an assembly of so many respected legal scholars and legal people, we would like to know if it's possible to engage the question of Su Jiyong and the New Citizens Movement from a legal point of view. They have been sentenced for inciting to gathering a public assembly, this is a very strange crime. There's something possible. And this morning there was talk about the maintenance of stability. I would like to say that there are huge resources engaged by the Chinese government in order to support this stability enforcement program. I wrote a book which has just been published about encounters with the Guobao, public security, and there you see how it works. We would like to raise this question and to know if people in this assembly can do something about that. Thank you.
I was just suggesting that we could continue lots of the discussion at the reception, because we really, I think it would be, Harold has been very patient, and I think we really,
want
to make Harold be more patient? That's okay.
I have a 30-second comment.
Okay, quick.
Me too.
Ryan asked what the influence of China would be on the Human Rights Committee if they did approve the ratification of the covenant. I just want to say that this treaty strengthening process that's been going on for the last year has been motivated by China. They have had an outsized influence on treaty body reform. Because they are organized, focused on the issues, relentless, and they're not unwilling to use bullying or intimidation tactics.
Sharon, you must be the last comment.
I'm Sophie.
Yeah, she'll do it because she's not Sharon.
Sorry.
Go, Sophie.
Yes, we actually have written about Bo Xilai with Jerry. And at the end of the day, honestly, I'm just as worried about what happens to people in Shanghai as in RTL. Arbitrary detention is arbitrary detention, and there are still lots of forms on the books. Go Canada, you guys have done a great job, but not only does UPR need to come out of the Human Rights Council. I mean, I got asked by lots of journalists around the Cao Shun Li case why we should, does anybody really care about the Human Rights Council? And my answer to that was, she did, right? And so in that sense, I think there's a real obligation on all of us to make that process as useful to people as possible, but I think there's still a lot of room for public education and for making it more meaningful for people. And then last but not least, I think there will continue to be enormous interest in the New Citizens Movement and in Su Jiyong and in this generation of extraordinary people who, to a large extent, I think were shaped by Tiananmen and who are really, I think, the great source of interest and optimism for the human rights movement inside China.
That's a great close, Sophie.
A good close, Sophie. Thank you for your patience. Thank you, Harold. There is no break. You go straight to the keynote.